The Music Marathon, only on VH1.
I'm a real wild one.
Wild one.
Wild one.
Wild one.
He's a misfit named Iggy, whose music is anything but pop.
He was famous for being partly naked, having a great body, and a big
Iggy Pop is the high priest of punk, with a rap sheet to match his attitude.
By the time I was 18, I'd had my first mugshot and spent my first night in jail, and first car accident, first drunken experience, all the good stuff.
First with his band, The Stooges, then later as a solo performer, Iggy Pop put his soul into his music and his life on the line.
We'll go to the stage and listen to Iggy and The Stooges.
There was something with Jimmy that I hadn't seen in rock and roll.
He never sold out. He's indestructible in that way. And if that ain't punk rock, I don't know what is.
But the pugnacious punk rocker pushed himself too far.
He took one of my carving knives and cut himself on stage.
I looked down and I was covered in blood.
I'm living like a dog. I'm bored.
An addiction to heroin almost destroyed him.
I'm pulling needles out of his arm. That was the serious demise.
Was shooting up every day and passing out every night and drinking and drugging and screwing and defying.
Lost in Iggy's excess was his relationship with his only child.
That picket fence and a Labrador retriever and a house and a mom and dad. That just wasn't the case in my circumstances.
Now, a VH1 exclusive. For the first time ever, Iggy, his son, and the surviving Stooges tell the tale of rock and roll's original wild child.
Some people thought I was arrogant. Some people thought I was crazy. Some people thought I was funny. All were correct.
Iggy Pop, the story behind the music.
I would rather be a 100% all f***ing beef for real American dog than some scum-sucking Johnny come on the trend masturbation bastard.
For more than 30 years, Iggy Pop has defied the rules, destroyed convention, and disgusted audiences.
He's out there almost daring you to come up and take him on. You know, he's up there flipping you the bird and pulling his pants down as far as they'll go without legal sanction.
His music is loud. His in-your-face attitude is dangerously rebellious. Together, they earn this prototypical pop star the reputation as the godfather of the punk movement.
I'm proud of everything I've done on stage. Everything.
So like I say to you, kiss my ass. Here's my ass. Come and kiss it.
I apologize for nothing.
You suck f***ing dog turds. Kiss my butt.
My responsibility is a good show.
Go read a book and flunk a test, you f***ing. Come on, come on.
He put his finger in his throat and, you know, over the edge of the stage.
I've known Iggy. Where'd he go? He's gone from the stage. Now Rory's going, oh my God, he's taking a behind the amps.
Iggy says he was just putting on a show, living in the music of the moment.
I wouldn't put too fine a point on it, my dear. I would just say that, again, that these are things that happened.
It's that angry defiance combined with his sheer will to survive that has made Iggy Pop one of the most renowned acts in rock and roll. But Rage's reigning rocker isn't a product of slick makeup and marketing. According to Iggy, his anger is an emotion he cultivated from an early age.
I went to a school where there were a lot of rich kids, and there was a lot of competitiveness, and all the cruel and stupid high school rituals which are detailed in so many movies. And going through that really made me pissed off. And I just buried the anger for use at a later date.
The seeds of Iggy's discontent can be traced back to Ann Arbor, Michigan, where Iggy was born James Newell Osterberg in April 1947. A wealthy Detroit suburb, Ann Arbor has its share of tree-lined streets and lavish homes. But Iggy says he clearly lived on the wrong side of the tracks.
I grew up in a trailer park on the side of a, by the side of a two-lane U.S. highway in a rural area with a cornfield directly behind my house or a trailer and a gravel pit behind that and a lot of forests.
The son of a teacher, Iggy was a smart, hardworking kid who did well in school. He even ran an ambitious but unsuccessful campaign for class president. According to classmate Ron Ashton, Iggy was as straight-laced as they come.
He was actually the guy that wore the chinos and the penny loafers with the dime in them, or the penny, and, you know, a cashmere sweater. And he was totally straight.
Until I was like 17, you know, my dad was still telling me, you know, what socks to wear and dictating my haircut.
Iggy drummed his way through two local bands while still in high school. For Iggy, music was the medicine that would unleash the savage beast.
The day I got out of high school, I walked out of school through one of the nicest neighborhoods in Ann Arbor, and I threw my papers all over the place. I didn't pick them up, and I grew my hair as fast as I could down to my shoulders, dyed it platinum with Clairol Ultra Blue, and got myself arrested very quickly.
He needed a new name to fit his new image. Eventually, mild-mannered Jim Osterberg became freewheeling Iggy Pop. And in 1966, after just one semester of college, Iggy dropped out to pursue music full-time. He wanted to front a band, so he gave his old buddy Ron Ashton a call.
I get a phone call from him going, I've decided that I don't want to be a drummer anymore. I want to start a band. And he wanted to start a band with my brother and myself.
With Ron on guitar, his brother Scott on drums, and their friend Dave Alexander on bass, the group took shape. The foursome called themselves the Psychedelic Stooges, and in March of 68, they played their first public gig.
We were all pumped up. Iggy wanted to do something that was totally different. So he shaved his eyebrows off, he covered his face with baby oil, and then took hands full of glitter and threw it into his face.
Few in the audience could believe their ears or their eyes. Iggy's onstage antics defied description.
What he wanted is to get a reaction out of the audience, and a lot of it was more sexual.
There was a lot of attitude. I think I was doing a lot of things a lot of people would have liked to be doing.
It was the spring of 1968, and Iggy was celebrating all the freedoms ushered in by the summer of love. Backstage at a gig at the Grandy Ballroom in Detroit, he consummated a relationship with a 16-year-old girl named Paulette Benson.
We had had a relationship which was semi-platonic. And we had broken up, and we'd been broken up for a long time. And she had been a virgin. But one night, she came up to me and said, hey, let's, you know. And I said, well, okay. Let's.
After their fleeting encounter, Paulette and Iggy went their separate ways, unaware their fling would change both their lives forever. Iggy, now 21, was hell-bent on pursuing his dreams. He moved into a farmhouse on the edge of Ann Arbor with his bandmates.
The dream was this. I could be in a band. I could live with my friends. We could pool all our money and buy smoke, buy marijuana, and buy hash. We could take acid together. We could take the living room, which you always hated and when we lived with mom and dad, and turn that into a practice room and have big amplifiers there. Life could be a party.
The word on the street became tune in, turn on, and drop out. And so we did.
But the band did manage to knock out some worthwhile tunes. And in September of 68, at a gig at the University of Michigan Student Union, the foursome hit pay dirt.
Iggy as a performer, I mean, was the most incredible thing I'd ever seen.
Danny Fields was at the show that night. He was blown away by what he saw and rushed to sign the Psychedelic Stooges.
I said, hi, I'm Danny Fields from Electric Records. I really liked your act. And he didn't even look at me.
He approached me after the gig and said, you're a star. And I thought, well,
this guy wants to pick me up or something. I don't know, you know.
The following morning, Danny tracked Iggy down and offered the foursome $5,000 to sign with Elektra Records. The band promptly accepted, and on Field's advice, shortened their name to The Stooges.
I certainly knew we weren't going to be the Mamas and Papas or the Rolling Stones at that point, but I thought we could, with a little skill applied, we could find a place that would allow us to make music and grow.
Next, Iggy discovers he's going to be a pop.
She had a little bulge. I thought, oh. And she said, yeah, you know, I'm pregnant.
And later, Iggy slams headlong into heroin.
I looked under the stalls, and there was Iggy lying on the floor, passed out with a needle in his arm.
When Behind the Music continues.
The presenters, Bono, Ray Charles, Eric Clapton, Sean Puffy Combs, Lauryn Hill, Chris Isaak, Elton John, Bonnie Raitt. The inductees, Billy Joel, Paul McCartney, Bruce Springsteen, Curtis Mayfield, Del Shannon, Dusty Springfield, the Staple Singers, and more.
But every week, over 500 family farmers go out of
day to day.
In the fall of 68, the Stooges had a recording contract and 4 plane tickets to New York. They were headed to the Big Apple to record their debut album. The 21-year-old Iggy Pop was about to get the biggest wake-up call of his life. His backstage fling with 16-year-old Paulette Benson had conceived a child.
She called me up at one point and said, hey, I got to talk to you. And she came over and she had a little bulge. And I thought, oh. And she said, yeah, you know, I'm pregnant.
A few months later, on February 26, 1969, Iggy's son Eric was born. Paulette says that when Iggy laid eyes on the baby, he wanted to do the right thing. Iggy popped the question, but the marriage was not to be.
I don't think either of us were really, we're really ready for that. The poles weren't meeting.
A few weeks later, Iggy left Paulette and his newborn son and flew to New York to record the Stooges' first album. But when it was released later that summer, the Stooges attracted little more than a cult following.
We did really well with social deviants, high school dropouts, people with lousy jobs, you know, alcoholics, drug addicts. We did great.
It was another year for me and you, another year with nothing to do.
Undaunted, the band returned to the studio the following spring to record its second album, Funhouse, then promptly hit the road. In June of 1970, Iggy popped off a performance that would pave the way for punk.
I was walking over the crowd. They just had their hands up like this, and I just knew I could walk on them. I just walked on them, and it was a beautiful thing. It felt like Jesus.
He'd antagonize that audience. Come on, participate in this show. Be a part of it. Come on, wake up, you people.
At some point, a hand shot up from the crowd with a jar of peanut butter. And I just took the peanut butter and started throwing it, just throwing it around.
No one knew what Iggy was going to do next. Nothing rehearsed, except that he was going to get up there and let one go.
Iggy was developing into an explosive showman on stage, but admits that he and the other band members were developing serious drug habits off stage.
We'd all smoke ourselves silly. Later, started taking LSD before I'd work. And then there are stimulants and there are various depressants.
By the summer of 1970, everyone in the band but guitarist Ron Ashton was abusing heroin.
And from that time on, things started to go downhill. Things started to break up.
Dave Alexander was the first to go. He was fired after an important show because he was so stoned that he could barely play. Iggy eventually hired his friend James Williamson to replace him, but according to Danny Fields, the change in lineup was just a quick fix.
They were descending into a miasma of out of control and drugs and occasional performances.
I'm going, gee, I think I'll play the piano today. Huh? It's gone, traded for dope. Equipment started missing. Then there were no practices. And it was just, we went through the motions of playing only to make money to get drugs.
When the band did manage to book a gig, Iggy could barely make it onto the stage.
I was in the bathroom looking for Iggy, time to get ready. And I looked under the stalls and there was Iggy lying on the floor, passed out with a needle in his arm. He was a junkie. He was a junkie. He was on heroin.
I don't think there was any common vision for the band anymore.
After only 6 months in the Stooges, it was clear to newcomer James Williamson that the band was in shambles.
Just was a bunch of guys, you know, that didn't have anything else to do at that point and didn't really want to be doing that, but didn't have anything else.
No fun, my babe. No fun.
The Stooges were disintegrating, and in the spring of 71, Elektra Records dropped the band from its roster. With few gigs and little equipment left to pawn, Iggy decided it was time to leave the group, and more importantly, time to kick heroin.
He was either going to become a total junkie and die, or get off of it.
I went back to my parents, and they had a friend who, against the law at that time, ordered a bottle of methadone for the pharmacy. And every morning I would walk a couple of miles to the pharmacy for the exercise and take my methadone.
Heroin free, but now dependent on methadone, Iggy quickly hashed out some new songs. In September of 71, he flew to New York hoping to meet someone who would help him revive his career. Late one night at a downtown club, he met David Bowie. Immediately, the two formed a fast friendship.
Bowie was more sociable than a lot of his American counterparts. And his manager was a hoot with a big cigar, an afro, and a giant mink coat. And I thought, well, this guy's got an image.
Bowie encouraged his manager, Tony DeFries, to sign his new friend. And in December, Iggy landed a deal with Columbia Records. After weaning himself off methadone, Iggy traveled to London, where the Stooges reunited. By early 72, the band started rehearsing for their third album, Raw Power. During the band's entire stay in England, they only performed one show, but it proved to be a landmark event.
The whole genesis of punk rock in England and America, people look to certain points, and there's certainly the Iggy and the Stooges show in London, 72.
That show changed the history of English music because of who was there. And people checked us and realized that we changed the playing field of what was cutting edge.
Iggy came out there and was jumping and grabbing girls by the hair, and you know, stuff was happening, and they were absolutely, you know, running for the doors. I mean, it was just unreal. People were frightened of us.
By the end of 72, after several months in the studio, the Stooges were finished with their album, or so they thought. The record was rejected by the label, and David Bowie was hired to remix it. Management decided to ship Bowie and the Stooges 6,000 miles to Los Angeles to complete the chore.
They put us up in the Beverly Hills Hotel, which was very cool, and we'd come down to Sunset Boulevard every day, and Bowie was mixing the album.
But even with Bowie's help, Raw Power didn't sell, and consequently, the band only played a handful of shows. With idle time on their hands, Iggy and his three Stooges returned to their old habits.
We got bored, and after a while, hey, well, you know, a little, they'd always smoke marijuana, but, you know, a little Seconal tonight won't be, you know, that's okay. And then it started slowly, because we weren't playing or doing anything, slowly kind of got back into that old grind.
After Raw Power, we lived in California, and there was a lot of drugs out there, and we were doing them.
Next, Iggy Pop lands in the cuckoo's nest.
I got a call from a psychiatrist. He said, I've got a Santa Claus, a Jesus Christ, two Virgin Marys, and an Iggy Pop that says you're his manager. You know, what's the story here?
And later, a son follows in his father's footsteps.
One night he went out with one of his little friends and drank a fifth of Jack Daniels and vandalized a school.
When Behind the Music continues.
There's the news you need. Then, there are the stories you want.
That she wasn't a bra in the back of the car. I mean, the girl's got great cans, what can I say?
VH1's new news magazine, Rock Candy. Ah!
Body!
Hard-hitting questions.
You think you could take Hanson in a fight?
Yeah, I do.
Undercover expo.
Me for you.
In the spring of 73, Iggy Pop and the Stooges were in Los Angeles, anxious to tour to support their third album. But their management decided a full-scale tour wasn't a viable option because the band had a limited following.
It had been a very frustrating time. We were not allowed to tour because supposedly there was no demand for us, etc., etc., etc.
With little to do, the band grew bored. After 2 years of struggling to stay clean, Iggy says temptation prevailed.
We were doing anything but music because we didn't have any music to do. I mean, we'd go out to clubs every night. We'd have girls over. We'd, hang out.
Drugs were just there. Everybody had them. If you had a girlfriend or two or three, they all had drugs, so then you had three suppliers of drugs right there.
Give me a danger, little stranger, and I'll give you a fee.
The band's drug use, coupled with their lack of commercial appeal, was enough to convince Columbia Records to drop the Stooges. By the summer of 73, so did their management. While the band struggled to find its footing, Iggy fell deeper into drugs and alcohol.
He was just, destructing, right? He's just, he's got a lot of energy. It was misdirected at that point. Just getting drunk and crazy or wild or whatever,
Iggy was drinking a lot, and it was a mess.
Danny Sugarman, who worked with the Doors, was a fixture on the L.A. music scene. He says Iggy was out of control, but still possessed something special.
I had total faith in him. I mean, especially after I saw him perform. I mean, I was certain that he would rise above his circumstances and make a great record and do a great tour.
Within a few months, the band found new management and set out on a U.S. tour. But by then, Iggy was again abusing heroin, and his performances were becoming increasingly obscene.
Was shooting up every day and passing out every night and drinking and drugging and screwing and defying.
So here we're doing a show. He goes rolling around semi-nude doing something to some woman or a few times. My God, what's she doing to his,
He would go to shows and people would joke about it in the lobby, Well, what's he going to do tonight? Is he going to pull his pants down? Is he going to dive into the audience?
The more outrageous Iggy was on stage, the more the crowds flocked. And while his antics had always been disturbing, in July 1973, at a club in New York, they turned dangerous.
Somehow I got cut on the bottom of a broken off cocktail glass on the stem, and there was a lot of blood. And I didn't notice it at first. I just kept singing along, and the more I sang and the more I moved, the more the blood pumped. And I looked down and I was covered in blood.
People were turning their heads and trying not to look. He saw the reaction he got on them, and I think he liked it.
Iggy had definitely gotten the crowd's attention, but in doing so, he had unleashed a monster. Where once fans threw pantyhose and pills on stage, now they began hurling beer bottles and lit cigarettes.
It got to be where it was no longer fun to play. It was just a job and going through the motions and to be afraid.
I was seeing all kinds of cameras whizzing by my ears and bottles and it's breaking all over the place, and it was pretty wild. I think everybody sort of was going, why do we need this?
In February 1974, the Stooges called it quits. By then, Iggy was a full-fledged junkie, living on the streets or wherever his search for drugs took him. Nevertheless, he managed to make a bizarre and bloody solo appearance at a club on LA's Sunset Strip in August 1974.
I wrote a concept piece called The Death Murder of a Virgin and decided to perform it at Rodney Bingenheimer's English Disco.
He called me up and said, hey, I want you to be a Nazi, beat me on stage.
He wanted me to call everyone in town and tell him this would be his greatest performance ever. And he took one of my carving knives and cut himself on stage.
The end of the show was Iggy in, this is what he wanted, mind you, Iggy in gunny sack and drug out and thrown in the gutters of Sunset Boulevard. And I think that's the last time I ever saw him in a long, long time.
By early 75, Iggy's body could no longer handle the drug abuse. When Iggy woke up alone in an abandoned building vomiting, Iggy says he knew he needed to get help. Soon after, he checked himself into a psychiatric hospital.
I got a call from a psychiatrist. I'll never forget it. He said, "This is Dr. Murray Zucker. I'm in charge of admissions at UCLA's Neuropsychiatric Institute. And I've got a Santa Claus, a Jesus Christ, two Virgin Marys, and an Iggy Pop that says you're his manager. You know, what's the story here?"
I checked myself into the Neuropsychiatric Institute in LA because there were no system of rehab in America at the time. I just wanted to get locked up for a month.
For Iggy, the month-long stay in the hospital was a humbling experience. His years of hard living and hard drugs had destroyed his career. Sober for the first time in years, Iggy began to face the consequences of his past.
I really had absolutely nothing going on in my life. It was really, things looked grim. And I had to go on faith at that point. And that was very, very rough to keep going.
It was David Bowie who helped Iggy get back on his feet. After visiting Iggy several times in the hospital, Bowie convinced his friend to join him on tour. In late 75, after Iggy's release, the two set out on a trip around the world.
I am a passenger, and I ride, and I ride.
The experience inspired Iggy to get his life back on track. That included reaching out to his 6-year-old son, Eric, whom he hadn't seen in several years. While on the road, Iggy wrote to him, sharing the tales of his journey.
"Dear Eric, I am writing this letter on a train going from Holland to Paris, France. I had my birthday in Russia, and we had a party right on the train. I am 29 years old now. Love, Dad."
Looking at these letters brought a warm feeling, you know, knowing that he's experiencing things for the first time in Europe, taking trains across the countryside and expressing to me what he's seen and experiencing.
After the tour, David and Iggy moved to Berlin, where they were determined to create new music together, free from the influence of drugs.
I think both myself and Iggy had indulged ourselves tremendously, and we decided we'd clean up. So we chose Berlin, the heroin capital of Europe, as we found out later.
That's pretty accurate, actually. Go to the heroin capital to kick heroin. Typical day, it would work like this. If a week has 7 days, and out of the 7 days, there would still be, for old times' sake, 2 binge days. Then the next 2 days after that were recovery days. But that leaves 3 days a week to do normal things, which is a lot for a musician.
Despite their binges, Ziggy and Iggy managed to create some classic songs. Long before Bowie made it famous, Iggy recorded China Girl on his album, The Idiot. Bowie produced Iggy's first two solo albums and played keyboards on tour with him in 1977. With Bowie's help, Iggy was exposed to audiences he never dreamed of reaching.
Iggy Pop is considered to be the originator of what is called punk rock today.
The proto-punk took his R-rated act to Dinosaur's G-rated show. But instead of the usual talk show chit-chat, Iggy shocked Dinah and housewives across America with stories about his notorious past.
You were doing things to yourself physically that were...
Yeah, and to other people, too.
But you cut yourself with a bottle.
Yeah, well, that was because I'd done something really foolish the night before, and I was ashamed. And I felt so bad that I thought, the heck with it, and I grabbed a glass. And
oh,
Jim,
but
that
boy.
Was, well, I've had treatment for that sort of thing, you know, since. Yeah, helped a lot, you know.
Iggy made a big impression on Middle America, especially on his 7-year-old son who was watching at home in Detroit. Though he had spent little time with his father, Eric was proud of his pop.
The understanding was that, you know, my dad worked and he was gonna be away when he was working, and that was pretty much all the time, so.
In the fall of 77, Iggy played the Motor City. For the first time in several years, Eric had the rare chance to spend time with his father.
Just noticing all the attention that people paid to him, you know, it's for a little kid to see that. I think it was a pretty big impact, and you know, just spending some time with him backstage and getting to know him, I guess, you know.
And I was happy to see him, and that was nice. It was moving. I think it was one of those moments where he was looking at me, I was looking at him. It's kind of like, oh, you know.
Though he was far from a full-time dad, from then on, Iggy saw his son more frequently. But soon after his relationship with Eric was starting to bloom, his partnership with David Bowie was beginning to sour. After two albums and a tour, the two decided it was time to go their separate ways.
We'd had enough of each other. It's like, I don't like the way you smoke your cigarette anymore. More like that, you know. I don't like your hair. Oh yeah? Well, I don't like your shirt. Oh yeah, well, I don't like your girlfriend. Oh yeah, well, I don't like your mother. You know, it's like silly shit, musician shit.
By late 1978, Iggy had moved to London to work on a new solo album, but he soon became as absorbed in alcohol as he was in his music.
I'm living like a dog. I'm bored.
I was really starting to fall apart by this point, toward the end of the 70s. I had a foot in the gutter and one in the office.
Next, Iggy's addiction takes center stage.
I've lost the ability to recollect my past as of 16 hours ago. I can't imagine where I was.
And later, like father, like son.
He was a young, good-looking kid. He had girls flag in, girls flag out, and dramas and substances and the works.
When Behind the Music continues. America.
You're watching a Behind the Music marathon, only on VH1. On Wednesday at 9, 8 Central, Paul, Bruce, Billy, and more music legends are getting into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in a ceremony you'll only see on VH1. While you're watching, look for the VH1 Rock and Roll Hall of Fame sweepstakes phone number. Give us a ring, and you could be the big winner. Big shot. We'll fly you and a guest to Cleveland. Yeah. Put you up in a swanky hotel, hand you $1,000, and take you on a VIP tour of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Plus, you'll go home with a rock and roll.
By 1980, Iggy Pop was in trouble again. He was touring heavily in an effort to jumpstart his career. But life on the road soon led him down the familiar path of alcohol and drug abuse.
Listen, I mean, what am I doing but laying on my back? You know, I mean.
In this rare interview, it's clear Iggy was intoxicated, angry, and disillusioned.
For years, you've been basically a cult, what they call a cult artist.
Like, what, you're telling me? What the f*** do you know?
Is rock and roll just entertainment, or is it more than that?
A lot of it has to do with a way to be so relaxed you can sit on your back while some turd is talking to you, you know? You know what I mean? Look at my friend, take heart in the fact that you've got me in your wonderful camera eye. You know, what more can you ask? You know?
3,000 miles away in Los Angeles, Iggy's 11-year-old son Eric was following in his father's footsteps. He may have been living with his mother, but he was behaving more like his pop.
He gotten to the point where his a lot of anger, probably a lot of it having to do with me, had come to the surface, and he was punching holes in the walls and skipping school.
The way a kid acts out is, you know, does what other kids are doing around him. And at that time, it was drinking and doing drugs.
His mother called me, and she said, this kid's out of control. I can't handle him anymore. I've had enough. You take him. And I said, send him out. I can handle anything.
In late 1980, Eric went to live with Iggy in New York, but Iggy's world was no place for a kid. Instead of going to school and doing his homework, the sixth grader was going to bars and watching his father do drugs.
He lived the life I lived, exactly as I did. Just hit all the bars day and night and did everything. Did drugs, girls. He could only, I mean, he was a little young for the girls.
I ran around the city with him at night, and to a small degree, you know, helped take care of him in some instances. you know, it wasn't a place for a kid to be around, but that's where I was.
That may have its horrifying aspect to some people, but that's who I was, and I shared that with him, at least.
It wasn't the kind of guidance Eric's mother had hoped Iggy would provide their son. Within months of his arrival, Eric was back home in L.A. More than a year would pass before father and son were reunited again. In the spring of 83, Iggy checked himself into a West Coast hospital, once again trying to beat his addictions.
Eric and his mother visited me in hospital a couple times, you know, tried to give me support and all that. They you know, that's the typical, you need family support and all that. Yeah.
I remember going to some therapy sessions with him and just visiting him in his room, you know, and he seemed tired, but yet at peace and just relaxed and wanting to get better. So it was, you know, good for me to be there and be supportive, but in the end, you know, he had to do it for himself.
But Iggy checked out before he completed his treatment. In June, he set out on a tour of Japan. It was there he fell in love with a fan named Suchi, whom Iggy says gave him the strength to kick drugs once and for all.
Suchi played a large role in helping Jim recover. She helped take care of him for many years, and for him to get back on his feet, you know, not just emotionally, but physically, I think, and it made him a stronger person.
I depended on her in certain ways, and we've both gotten a lot of rewards out of that. Perhaps I leaned on her, as you might lean on somebody who would be there to keep you from getting yourself in trouble.
The very month he met Suchi, Iggy got another boost. China Girl, a song he had written 5 years earlier with David Bowie, went top 10. The publishing royalties allowed Iggy to stay off the road and settle down. In October 1984, Iggy and Suchi got married.
At that point in his life, you know, getting normal was probably the most radical thing he could do. He kind of found out how he could channel himself into family life.
But just as Iggy settled into a life of sobriety, his son Eric dove headfirst into the party circuit. Despite witnessing drugs nearly destroy his father, 15-year-old Eric was now abusing drugs himself.
You say to yourself, you're not going to make those same mistakes. But in the end, you do, and you have to learn from them on your own.
He was a teenager, and he came to visit one time and stay for a week. One night he went out with one of his little friends and drank a fifth of Jack Daniels and vandalized a school, smashed all the windows in some school and got caught. So I had to come and haul him out of jail.
While Eric spent the next few years struggling with his addictions, Iggy's own sobriety was paying off. In 86, Iggy reunited with David Bowie for his seventh solo album. Soon after its release, Iggy scored his first U.S. hit single, Real Wild Child. Well, I'm just out of school. In the early 90s, Iggy hit pay dirt again with Brick by Brick. Finally, it seemed as if his unique brand of music was striking a chord with a mainstream audience, whether he liked it or not.
They had to drag me in screaming and kicking to get me anywhere near commercial success. What to do was to please myself in all the music I've made and all the words I've had to say is to please myself. And then if you like it, great. If you don't, f*** you.
Next, Iggy battles dope one last time.
I told him when he was a kid for years, when you're old enough, I'll take you out of the road with me. And it was a bloody disaster.
When Behind the Music continues.
Making music they believed in made REM a monster success. But the constant pressure,
I felt forced to talk about my sexuality,
had its price.
And a lot of fun right up until right now. I'm sorry.
VH1 Behind the Music, coming up next, REM. Behind the Music is sponsored by Visa. It's everywhere you want to be.
In 90, Iggy Pop had taken on sobriety and success with the same passion that had once fueled his addictions.
Once I decided to sober up, I really took the ball and ran with it. And as I did so, I found my orientation changing.
In 1991, at age 44, he was ready to take a more fatherly role in his son Eric's life. Iggy recruited the 22-year-old to work with him on tour.
it was partly an effort on his part, I think, to give me some direction and get out of Los Angeles, basically, and do some things more positive for myself and learn.
I told him when he was a kid for years, when you're old enough, I'll take you out of the road with me, and it was a bloody disaster. So he was like a kid in a candy store. Young, good-looking kid. And, wow, I'm on tour. I've got room service. I got cash. We're in a different town every day. And he had girls flying in, girls flying out, and dramas and substances and the works.
As the tour wore on, Eric's drug use escalated, and by 1993, it was out of control. Finally, in May of 1994, Eric got the help he needed.
I got him professional help, basically. There are people who do that. I'm not really the kind of guy that's gonna sit you down and give you some good life advice. That's not my forte.
Today, both Eric and Iggy are drug-free, and their relationship is as solid as it is unconventional. In fact, Eric is training to be Iggy's tour manager.
His best line about it now is, you know, people ask me, how does it feel to have to pull your dad out of the crowd when he's stage diving, you know?
On stage, his energy level is so high, the adrenaline is so much, that I really try to keep an eye on him and watch him to make sure he's not gonna hurt himself.
He's very protective toward me in a way I don't think anyone could be outside of a relationship of basically being the closest blood relative that a man can have.
Now in his 50s, Iggy is enjoying more success than he ever dreamed possible. Not only has he connected with his son, he's now connecting with fans the world over.
Somewhere in the 90s, all the old records that didn't sell at the time started to sell a little more and a little more, and they started getting used in films, and then after the films, advertisers. My policy on that is use them for sausage, use them for cars. I do not care because they were not commercially conceived.
But the success Iggy worked so hard for came with a price. It cost him his relationship with the one woman who stood by his side for 14 years. In 1999, he and Suchi divorced.
And me, I'm sitting in my castle on the verge of a divorce.
The cumulative weight of all the work we did together in bringing my career from 0 to 60 pretty much killed my marriage with Suchi. There wasn't a life there for us that was sustainable.
But the lessons of the breakup haven't been lost on him. Despite the divorce, Iggy is looking for love and family to balance his career.
I'd like to have another child. I'd like to have the experience of raising it. I'd like to have a wife and a family totally outside of this. On the other hand, I don't think that's very realistic because that's not who I am. So perhaps I'll find something in between.
Today, Iggy lives in Miami and spends much of his time in New York. After more than 30 years of wild parties, world tours, and raging excess, Iggy Pop has accomplished what many once thought impossible. He survived.
I sort of feel like a rockin' old dude, yeah. I don't have any advice for anybody, you know, anything like that. But, yeah, I like where I am.
He survived things that he did to himself. He survived the things that the business did to him.
He's older than I am, and he's out there jumping into the mosh pits.
And yet, here he is. He only gets bigger and better.
And you're an entertainer to the degree that he is, then you don't want to stop. You can't.
Tuesday night, spend some time with the legends of rock and roll. Stevie Ray Vaughan, John Fogerty, the Bee Gees, John Lennon, and Queen. Tuesday night, starting at 6, 5 Central. And don't forget to catch the Class of 99 as they get inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Wednesday night at 9, 8 Central, only on VH1.
This is